to read just a few verses here before Brother Paul brings the message today. In Galatians chapter 1, Paul's writing to a church here in Galatians, or in Asia Minor. They had heard the gospel. They had heard the word. They had accepted Christ as their Lord and Savior. They were living for the Lord. And false teachers came in and started teaching things contrary to the word. And specifically, it was on circumcision. They were telling these Gentiles that they needed to be circumcised, that they needed to become Jews before they could be accepted as Christians. In verse 6 of chapter 1 in Galatians, Paul writes, "I marvel that ye are so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel." They were teaching things contrary to the gospel of Christ, which is not another, but there are some that trouble you and would pervert the gospel of Christ. In verse 4 of 2 Corinthians 11, it says, "For if he that cometh preacheth another Jesus, whom we have not preached, or if we receive another spirit, which ye have not received, or another gospel, which ye have not accepted, ye might well bear with him." If you're going to listen to somebody else that's teaching things contrary to the gospel, you might as well go ahead and follow them. We're told, actually, in the same chapter in 2 Corinthians 11, verse beginning with 13, "For such are false apostles, deceitful workers, transforming themselves into apostles of Christ. And no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. Therefore, it is no great thing if his ministers also be transformed as ministers of righteousness, whose end shall be according to their works." In verse 8, Galatians 1, Paul says, "Though we, or an angel from heaven, preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed." We have the Bible now. This is the word that is preached. This is God's word. And this is what we need to follow. The church in Berea was told that, it's actually back in Acts 17, says that the Bereans were more noble than those in Thessalonica because they received the word with all readiness of mind and searched the scriptures daily whether those things were so. They checked out the scriptures. Paul preached, and after Paul preached, they went to the scripture to make sure those things were so. "As we said before, so say I now again, if any man preach any other gospel unto you than that ye have received," this right here, "let him be accursed. Or do I now persuade men or God? Or do I seek to please men? For if I yet pleased men, I should not be the servant of Christ." Each and every one of us have a priesthood. Each and every one of us need to talk to other people and let them know about the Lord. And we need to do it according to what God said, not according to what people want to hear. At this time, Brother Paul, bring the message.
Brother Dan. Hope nobody gets up and leaves, sorry. But, Brother Doc asked me back in December if I would fill in for him into April. I said, sure. About 3 weeks later, he said, "You're going to do my sermon for me, aren't you?" Then I got a little bit more nervous. So, as each week went by, it's a little tougher. But Dan's message kind of goes a little bit along with mine today, but my message isn't my message today. It's Christ. literally, it's forward today. And if you want to turn to your Bibles in Matthew chapter 7, and it's Christ's message of the Sermon on the Mount, which started back in chapter 5. And he tells us all the things that we need to do, all the Beatitudes. But I want to touch on the last part of his message today, and that is in chapter 7. And he tells us things that we need to do and things that we don't need to do. Starting with the first one in chapter 7, it says, "Judge not that ye be not judged. For with what judgment ye judge, ye shall be judged. And with what measure you meet, it shall be measured to you again." He says, "Why beholdest thou the mote that is in thy brother's eye, but considerest not the beam that is in thy own eye?" The mote, which is a speck, like a little sand. The beam is like a log. He says, "Or how wilt thou say to thy brother, let me pull out the mote out of thine eye, and behold, a beam is in thine own eye. Says, thou hypocrite, first cast out the beam out of thine own eye, and then shalt thou see clearly to cast out the mote out of thy brother's eye." He says, "Give not that which is holy unto the dogs, neither cast ye your pearls before swine, lest they trample them under their feet, and turn again and rend you." The illustration here is, like I say, is a small fault and a great fault. Both parties have the same fault. But the one having the greatest seeks to correct the one having the least. Galatians chapter 6 and 1 says, "We must first get rid of our own faults so that we can see clearly to help others." So we can't help someone else that has a problem if we have a problem that's bigger than theirs. Verse 7 says, "Ask and it shall be given you. Seek and you shall find. Knock and it shall be opened unto you. For everyone that asketh receiveth, and he that seeketh findeth, and to him that knocketh it shall be opened. Or what man is there of you whom, if his son ask bread, will he give him a stone? Or if he ask a fish, will he give him a serpent? If ye then, being evil, know how to give good gifts unto your children, how much more shall your Father, which is in heaven, give good things to them that ask him?" Jesus talks about the importance of prayer. We must seek, and we must ask, and we must knock. We should always be in mind to pray, asking and getting answers from God is the most important part of a Christian's life. And comparing the earthly things that the Father gives to His Son with the Heavenly Father, who will gladly give you what you need. He's not going to give you all the things that you want. But if you ask for godly things, He's going to gladly give these to you. He goes on to the golden rule. Verse 12 says, "Therefore all things whatsoever ye would that men should do to you, do ye even so to them. For this is the law and the prophet. Christ talks about the golden rule and how that we should be, we want to be treated, and how that we want to treat others, how we should treat others. And we're going to practice this. If we want to be treated good and kind, we need to show kindness and love and goodness to other people. Luke 6 and 31 says, ask. Says, as you would that men should do to you, do ye also like unto them. We can't expect somebody to treat us good in turn if we don't treat them good. As I said, this is not my message today. This is Christ's message. This is His word. And we need to live as closely to His word as we can. We're going to make mistakes. We're going to have faults. We're going to stumble. But He is always there to pick us up. He is always there to lend a hand. He's always near to you. He said, I will never leave you. I'll never forsake you. I'll go with you always to the end of the world. In the closing part of Christ's message on the Sermon on the Mount, which is close to the region of Capernaum, and it's a mountain area, as Brother Dan talked about false prophets, about people leading their brothers astray, preaching things that wasn't true, that's not Christ's gospel. And the things that Paul preaches about. How that we should need to study your word, and you need to dig into it and get the understanding from it. And if someone's preaching your word to you, you need to study your Bible and realize that what they're preaching is right. And if they're wrong, you need to stop. Verse 15 starts to talk about false prophets. It says, beware of false prophets which come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are raving wolves. You know, ye shall know them by their fruits. It says, do men gather grapes of thorns or figs of thistles? Even so, every good tree bringeth forth good fruit, but a corrupt tree bringeth forth evil fruit. A good tree cannot bring forth evil fruit, neither can a corrupt tree bringeth forth good fruit. It says, every tree that bringeth not forth good fruit is hewn down and cast into the fire. Wherefore, by their fruits ye shall know them. At the closing of Christ's message, he gave a series of two choices to the people that were listening to him. And His word today is true as it was then. It hasn't changed one bit. And His word, it's alive. Just as He spoke it over 2,000 years ago, Christ's word still speaks to you today. Still speaks to me. He said, I'm the same yesterday, today, and forever. He said, I change not. If there's any changing, it's us. I said, he gave a series of different things, two different ways that people are living. The first one was the straight gate. which I passed up just a minute ago. There's a narrow road, and there's a broad road. Which road are you traveling today? He said, I set good and evil before you. You choose this day whom you shall serve. The one that's on the narrow road and straight we travel, that's the road that leads to Christ and the everlasting kingdom he's prepared for you. The broad road is the road that leads to destruction. And he said, many there be that will be thereon. Which road are you traveling today? And false prophets Christ said that he is the way, the truth, and the life. If we come to the Father, we have to go through Christ to get to the Father. Christ is our door into everlasting life, eternal. When we accept Jesus Christ into our life, we accept what he's offered us. It's out there for you. It's free. It costs, it's free to us, but it costs God his son's life on the cross of Calvary for our sins. Verse 21 says, not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father, which is in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name? And in thy name cast out many devils, cast out devils, and in thy name have done many wonderful works. And then will I profess unto you, I never knew you, depart from me, ye that work iniquity. The two different trees that God talks about, one brings forth good fruit, and the other one brings forth bad fruit. And he also goes on to say that not everyone that says they are saved, they are saved. They claim to have done all these many wonderful works in the Lord's name, but outwardly, their hearts are not right with God. A genuine saved person is someone that does the will of the Father and is obedient to his will. Romans 2:13 says, for not the hearers of the law are just before God, but the doers of the law shall be justified. We have to be a doer of his word, not just a hearer. We have to apply what God tells us to do to our lives and to grow in his grace. There's two foundations that he tells us about. He says, therefore, whosoever heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them, I will liken him unto a wise man which built his house upon a rock. And the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat upon that house, and it fell not, for it was founded upon a rock. And every one that heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them not shall be likened unto a foolish man which built his house upon the sand. And the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew, and beat upon that house, and it fell, and great was the fall of it. It's two different people here, two different foundations, the wise and the foolish. The sand and the rock. here of Christ using the elements to make his point. He uses rock, rain, and the wind. The foolish build his house upon the sand, which the house collapsed. Not because of the labor, because he worked, but because of the foundation that he was building on, the shifting sand, the doctrines of men. When the rains and the winds begin to blow, and the storms of life crash down upon him, he wasn't able to stand. So it fell. The wise man that built his house upon the rock, he had a solid foundation. Because he dug down and he found the bedrock. He found the solid stone. And he began to build upon it. And he put his trust in it. You notice the bridge that they build on the highways and the roads, they're always repaving that blacktop to that road to come back up to the bridge. You notice why they do that. That bridge is built on a solid foundation. They dug down and they found the bedrock. They found a solid foundation. But the road keeps sinking. And they have to keep building it up to be level with the bridge. And that's what we need to do today. We need to find that bedrock. We need to build on that foundation, that solid rock, which is Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, that died on the cross for our sins. The wise man, he built on the solid rock. And when the storms of life came that beat upon the house, the winds blew and the storms came, it was able to stand. Because he had Jesus Christ in his heart. He had something that he could hold on to. He knew he had a solid foundation. Today, we must know the way that he spoke about. We must have the right fruit that others can see Christ in us, that we're bearing good fruit for him. We must choose the right profession. We must accept Jesus Christ into our hearts and work and labor for him. But we know that if we hold to his unchanging hand, that we have a better place that is waiting for us, that's over on the other shore. And Jimmy said he 59,000 feet that he's up in the air. I'm sure that we're going to be higher than that.
Amen.
And we must build on the right foundation. The foundation that was secure. Don't put your trust in man. Don't put your trust in someone that will lead you astray. But always put your trust and foundation in Jesus Christ our Lord. He's the way, the truth, and the life. I hope and pray that I brought something out today that will help you to grow, to be a little stronger in Christ. I know it took me a while to work on this lesson. But I kind of write my things down because I have a tendency to forget what I'm going to say. And that's why it's on paper. But I know someone that will lead me and guide me. Someone that can direct my path. Someone that can put me on the straight and narrow path that leads from earth to glory. That's the path that we all need to be on today. It's the path that Christ has laid out for you and I. To travel the straight and narrow road and to build on the solid foundation. If you're here today and you don't know Christ as your Savior, pray that you'll give your life to Him. Not today, somewhere down the line. He's standing there with outstretched arms for you. He's pleading, begging for you to accept Him as your Savior. And to start bearing that fruit of righteousness. Amen. As we stand and sing 522.